anyone can do it, not only me, also this is possible because it's a proven, I think anybody can do it anywhere else, even barren, rocky and bedrock and sheetrock, any kind of rock, they can do this kind of farming, it is possible.
In our last episode, we saw how DRCSC is working with tribal communities in West Bengal, lifting them from poverty to permaculture. From there, we headed southwest to the state of Telangana on the Deccan Plateau. The Deccan Plateau is in the rain shadow of the Western Ghats Mountains, so it's hot and dry for most of the year, averaging 650 millimeters of rainfall during the intense monsoon season. We started in the city of Hyderabad and wound our way out 200 kilometers into the countryside to visit the oldest permaculture farm in India.
How are you?
Fine,
good to see you.
Hi.
I'm here with Narsana and Padma Coppola, who are the founders of Aranya Agricultural Alternatives and the Aranya Permaculture Farm.
Aranya Permaculture Farm was founded in 1999, but Narsana's introduction to permaculture was as a younger man in 1987, when Bill Mollison, the Australian revolutionary designer who coined the term permaculture, showed up on the Deccan Plateau to meet with Narsana's guru, Dr. Venkat.
We're in India in the southern Deccan, about 2 hours by road north of Hyderabad.
Young Narsana was a revolutionary himself, working for social justice and equality. He began a lifelong friendship with Mollison and has worked tirelessly to spread permaculture throughout the Deccan Plateau. In the true permaculture spirit, Aranya Farm was founded on land that was declared by the government as a wasteland, a plateau eroded down to bare laterite bedrock where no human could scrape together a livelihood.
This stone is a bedrock. I think even there's not much porosity, not even cracks. Totally it's a sheet rock where water cannot be even sink and impound into the soil. Considered as a wasteland in this region. Even government records also, it's called a wasteland. The wastelands are not wastelands, they're wasted lands. That's the slogan I have taken. It's always wasted lands. We wasted it, not a wasteland. Most of the soils, they're not as a good and bad, they're a poor and rich. So same social structure if you take the poor people and rich people. Who will take care of the such poor people? Everybody neglect the soil science, everybody is caring only the fertile soils, who will take care of these kind of soils?
From this bare rock, Aranya Farm has grown into a mature food forest that shows the capacity of permaculture to create abundance in the harshest of conditions.
This is the land is totally barren. 20 years ago, there I planted a lot of trees. I started raising nursery. Then whatever I raised the nursery, there from that nursery, the saplings I planted in one area. Slowly, one by one, as a phase-wise, phase manner, I developed this entire this farm. But the first step would be the water harvesting. Second is I did my compost, the nursery, I'm plantation, and some crops. Only 10% of land I kept for annual crops, where I don't need to much do much work. So this is a perennial crops I put under almost 80% of the land put under perennials. Most of the trees have came on their own. Most of the trees, I think, is the bird drops. That's the very beauty of the entire farm. I think some lot of natural growth is happening after 10 years, but now it's the 20th year. 20th year, you can see it look like a mini forest.
The bounty at Aranya Farm is undeniable, full of food plants, native species, vegetable gardens, domestic animals, birds, flowers, and seeds. But the spectacular thing is how the water table has regenerated as the forest grew and the soil deepened. This is evident when we look at the hand-dug open well that supplies Aranya's now plentiful water.
When I came here, I think this totally bedrock, only little amount of soil all around the well. You can see the depth of the soil, only just 6 to 8 inches soil. The roots are penetrating into the hard rock, making small cracks. I think they totally started going inside and breaking the rock. On this farm, I think I'm maintaining the same water table because of planting trees. not only few trees, but different, not only trees, different sizes and the small bushes and shrubs and trees and plants all together. I think the root system, the network in the ground, that will hold more water. The water table has been maintaining since last 20 years. But over a period of 6 or 7, I could see a lot of water in the well. That's an indicator of your harvesting water through plants. Each plant is holding water. After saturation, when it reaches saturation, they are releasing water into the open wells like this. I think that's a great indicator. It's happened within just 10 years. Now it's the 20th year. I have plenty of water. I never short of water at all on this farm.
I needed to understand the practical steps in turning bedrock into a food forest. So we traveled off of the farm into the surrounding community to see some sites that are in the early stages of development.
The first primary activity which they did was to harvest the rainwater. This kind of trenches did in all the women's farmers' fields. And then on the top of the buns, they sow the seed. On the buns also, on the rocky area also, they could able to grow something. She planted the mango tree. And also she has done the water harvesting within the plant. Because it's all rocky area, the water is coming from there. And she could able to stop the water. And water can stay for longer time to the fruit trees. And at the same time, and she has done the mulching to hold the moisture for long time. Using the same moisture for to grow the vegetables like tomato, chilies, and she is showing the moisture. If you do the mulching, how the moisture looks like. All of the farmers collectively bringing the water to the tanker and putting into the tank. And from there, these people are using the bucket and giving the water to the plants. If you see the crescent structure, the slope is from that side. Water is coming here and staying for a long time. So she could able to 7 months, she has not given any irrigation to the plants, even though she could able to grow because of the water harvesting.
So essentially, they identified an area where there was a little bit of soil amongst the bedrock and dug that out to form a crescent-shaped berm that would intercept the rainwater sheeting off of the bedrock. A mango tree was planted in the basin with vegetables surrounding it, and the area was heavily mulched to retain moisture. Another method is to carve out a simple trench that is placed perpendicular to the flow of water. The soil is mounded to create a berm below the trench, and in that loose soil, seeds are sown. When monsoon rains fill the trench, seeds come up in the soft soil and grow from the residual moisture that is soaked in by the trench. Harvesting water in trenches and growing crops on the tops of berms is a recurring pattern, and they've really developed this method to help with the transition of wastelands into productive farms.
Why you did like this? What is this? She said, swale or trench. In their language, a trench. And what did you do here? They took out the soil from this portion and they raised the burn. On the burn, they planted a lot of trees. So why you did this? No, to stop the water, rainwater. Why did you across like this? Why can't you put like this? She said, it's a perpendicular, is the water flow is towards this side. Some water is percolated and some water is laterally moved, which helped the plants which we planted on the bun. Because of that moisture, we could able to see this greenery and these flowers are there. Otherwise, we never watered so far. They introduced a lot of trees, combination of food as a leguminous nitrogen fixers and some fruit plants. A little amount of water is enough to grow these plants because they're very hardy. At that time, they don't need much water and a lot of rainwater being harvested. Anybody can pluck the fruit and they eat. That kind of fair share is happening by planting these kind of trees. In one bund, you can introduce multiple species we have seen 7-8 varieties. The depth you can see, I can holding a lot of water. The growth of the trees you can see, able to see, which indicates most of the water has been being percolating here and not much erosion now. This is going to be one of the best example for the live fence. The food also available on the live fence along the roadside. At the same time, making a lot of water harvesting and a lot of soil has been regenerating and more production is available on the burn. Look at the multiple functions that it has.
A swale is dug perpendicular to the slope, which intercepts the surface rainwater flow and spreads the water out to soak into the ditch. The mound of loose soil is then planted with a diversity of perennial species. This is often conveniently placed along the boundary of a site, so it also serves as a living fence planted with fruits to feed the passerby, and can be positioned as a windbreak to further protect crops from the drying effects of winds. This is a very common technique used by Narsana, and it has proven its effectiveness over the decades since he installed the very first one.
So this is where I introduced my different concept of combining the live fence with the windbreak. When I was here, I think the beginning, totally what just now we have seen, the rocky area, no plant, nothing, only rocks, not even, there is no grasses, is not even blade of grass is not growing on this rocky area. But now is a war of almost 20, 25 years. Now it is totally full lush green. They started agriculture on this land after 10 years. That is how the transformation taken place. By doing this, I got a lot of confidence. Any land, any kind of soil can be transformed within 2 to 3 years. I introduced a lot of local species, very dry, at the same time, multiple ways, multiple trees, and the microclimate is totally different. Now, where I am standing, this cool is totally different from the hot sun. Now, this has become one of the big income for her. Only for tamarind, she sell every year some 25,000-30,000 rupees of tamarind. There's a big income for a small family in the rural area. I think that is how your life fences, you can combine with the windbreak as well. You can make a more resilient, at the same time, dry species, and it should be more some productive also. It's economically viable. At the same time, you're protecting your farm as well.
This project is much more than just the biophysical aspects of regenerating a wasteland into a water-rich food forest. There is a powerful dimension of poverty alleviation and social justice that is at the root of Narsana's motivation.
When I came here and I'm talking to the people, they were very hopeless on their lands by seeing these lands, but most of them are landless. So I approached the government, at the same time I approached the community, what is the possible way to get the land. That lands that belongs to government, but the enjoyed, that land should be enjoyed by the people. They are all untouchable community. They are not even totally neglected community in the village. I got land for each family. Today when I came to this village, 60% of people were landless. Now today almost every household has some piece of land. They said it's hopeless. I think we'll make it hopeful.
There are some who call Narsana the Gandhi of permaculture, as he works tirelessly not only to regenerate wastelands into paradisical food forests, but has succeeded in obtaining land for many of the landless poor of the untouchable caste, who are at the very bottom of India's social ladder. Some say that permaculture is a revolution disguised as organic gardening, and in Narsana and Padma Coppola's case, this is absolutely the truth. Like, subscribe, and join us for our next episode where we travel to a farming region on the verge of collapse in the drought-stricken state of Andhra Pradesh, where Aranya Agricultural Alternatives is funded by the government to build water resilience and replace chemical agriculture with sustainable practices.